It's a pleasure to invite Dr. Gali Havazelet-Heimer from Sheba Medical Center, and she will talk about Angelman syndrome from the clinic to the search for novel therapeutic strategies.
Thank you, Ditsa, and also I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to come and talk to you today. We'll just load up. Angelman syndrome was called after the British pediatrician, Dr. Harry Angelman, and it was discovered first at 1965 when he reported on three children who featured gait apraxia, epilepsy, lack of expressive language, and a happy demeanor. He named the syndrome the puppet children inspired by a painting, but the name was later on changed due to request of the families. Now, the incidence of the syndrome is 1 to 15,000 live births, and there is no predisposition for a specific sex, ethnicity, or consanguinity. In the past, it was diagnosed around 2 to 5 years of age with the appearance of distinct developmental, behavioral, and facial features. But nowadays, the diagnosis occurs much earlier owing to the CMA and the exome sequencing. In 2005, clinical criteria were established, and they talk about normal prenatal birth history, normal metabolic testing, and brain imaging. And the developmental delay usually is evident by 6 to 12 months of age and is characterized by slow forward progression with no regressions. The clinical diagnostic criteria are divided to consistent, which appear in all children. These include developmental delay, speech impairment, movement and balance disorder, and unique behaviors such as frequent laughters, overexcitability, and hyperactivity. The frequent features occur in most patients and consist of microcephaly, which appears usually by the age of 2 years. Seizures that usually appear by the age of 3 years and are characterized by increased heat sensitivity and abnormal characteristic EEG pattern, which you can see here with the slow, high amplitude background activity. The other class of features is the associated, and they include the unique dysmorphism, like the if you can see here, the wide mouth, the wide spaced teeth, pointed chin, but also neurological and behavioral features like truncal hypotonia, and later on increased peripheral spasticity with all its associated problems, eating disorders, sleep disorders, and other unique features like fascination with water and so on. So the genetic basis of Angelman syndrome was first discovered at 1987, and the region was located to the long arm of chromosome 15. Part of this locus is imprinted in neurons, and this is why we have actually four different genetic mechanisms that can all lead to Angelman syndrome. The most common one is the deletion of this region on the maternal allele, but also a paternal uniparental disomy, imprinting a center defect on the maternal allele, and a point mutation in the UBE3A gene on the maternal allele. Now, if you can see, what is common to all these four mechanisms is a UBE3A defect. So this UBE3A gene codes for the ubiquitin protein ligase, which is involved in the ubiquitination and the degradation of proteins in the cell. And if the ubiquitin is not working so well, then its target proteins would not be degraded. So the understanding of the genetic and the biochemical mechanisms of Angelman syndrome has actually led to the development of several therapeutic strategies to treat AS syndrome. These are actually grouped into three main groups. The first is aiming at the downstream pathways of the ubiquitin. The second, insertion of the intact UBE3A gene by vectors. And the third one is unsilencing the paternal UBE3A gene. So one of the target proteins, and I will just show a few examples from each. One of the target proteins of the UBE3A is the GAT1, which you can see here. It is in charge of reuptake of GABA. And when it is not degraded, there is too much reuptake of GABA, and we have a deficiency of extrasynaptic GABA. In 2012, Igawa and his group have discovered that there is a reduced tonic inhibition in the cerebellar cells of AS mice. And they also discovered that this tonic inhibition is actually mediated through the extrasynaptic GABA-A receptors, and that if you give the mice an agonist for these GABA-A receptors, you can improve both the firing patterns of the cells and also improve the motor deficits of the mice. Now, Ovid Therapeutics company, which specializes in repurposing of drugs, took this idea and tried to take it in order to suggest a therapeutic substance for AS. And they are currently concluding a large multicenter phase 2 randomized double-blind trial of gaboxadol in AS patients, in which my clinic was privileged to be the only site out of the US and one of the four largest recruiting centers. The gaboxadol is a selective extrasynaptic, the only selective extrasynaptic GABA-A receptor agonist that there is. And it was actually developed as a sleep medication. It was found safe and efficient for sleep improvement in over 3,000 adults with insomnia. And although the primary endpoint of the trial was the safety in AS patients, we also looked at the five secondary endpoints, which included the gross motor function, fine motor functions, sleep, behavioral, and general quality of life. Preliminary results suggest a robust significant improvement in the clinical global improvement scale in the treatment group compared to the placebo group. And we're expecting that the comprehensive results will be released later on this month, actually by the end of October. So another strategy was attempted by Ed Weber, and he tried to insert the intact UBE3A via an adeno-associated virus vector. He directly injected the vector to the hippocampi of the adult AS mice and showed both an increased expression of the UBE3A as well as improvement in tests of associative learning and partial improvement of LTP. Now, Agilis Biotherapeutics is trying to pursue this method and has recently received an orphan drug status from the FDA in order to do so. One of the greatest breakthroughs in the search for therapeutics of AS was when they discovered the antisense which mediates the paternal UBE3A silencing. So this is like we have an off-on switch. If we just switch it on, the cells could be normal again. So Ben Philpott and Mark Zilka were the first one who achieved the unsilencing of the dormant allele. And actually, they also did a drug screening similar to what's been described here previously of over 2,000 small molecules in cultured AS mouse cortical neurons with an engineered fluorescent labeled UBE3A on the paternal allele. So when it's expressed, you can see the fluorescence. And they demonstrated that irinotecan and topotecan, which are topoisomerase inhibitors, downregulated the expression of the antisense, transcript and activated the paternal UBE3A expression, as you can see here. They later on showed that this change was not mediated through a change of the methylation status and that the paternally expressed UBE3A was shown to be catalytically active. Finally, they demonstrated by in vivo injections to mice that injections either to the straightly to the brain or to the spinal fluids resulted in increased expression of the UBE3A that lasted for 56 weeks following the last injection. Now, unfortunately, we cannot use topotecan. This is a chemotherapy agent, and it has many problems. Among them are toxicity with synaptic depression, limited brain BBB penetrance, and possible off-target effects. However, people are looking for similar compounds which would be more suitable. The second strategy to cause unsilencing of the paternal allele was attempted by Art Bidet with the collaboration of Ionis Pharmaceuticals, and they used the antisense oligonucleotides. I don't know how many neurologists are here, but the ASOs have been recently used in SMA and have had great success. So they developed ASOs that binds to a specific sequence in the mouse, UBA antisense, and have demonstrated this, a single injection to the lateral ventricle of adult AS mice resulted in reduction of the antisense and upregulation of the UBE3A protein in several brain areas, which remained for up to 4 months. They also showed parallel improvement of behavioral tests in these mice. The ASOs also have some problems. The main one is that they are highly charged and do not penetrate the BBB, and repeated intrathecal injection will be needed. Also, obviously, if you would like to develop these strategies for human and not for mice, you need first to develop ASOs against the human antisense and then to test and approve those as well. And the last strategy that was developed for unsilencing the paternal allele was the most imaginative, I think. It was done by David Siegel, who is a protein engineering by his trade. And he engineered a protein that contains an artificial transcription factor, which is attached on one side to a zinc finger, which recognizes the promoter of either the UBE3A or its antisense, and on the other side to a membrane-penetrating peptide and a cherry red fluorescence dye. And now he tried both strategies of either increasing the UBE3A transcription or repressing the antisense transcription, and he found the latter one to be more efficient. Because of the protein penetrating, of the membrane penetrating peptide, this protein can be injected to the peritoneum of the mice, not intrathecally, and you see that it is nicely distributed evenly in the brain. And he've shown that his TATS1 construct, but not sham construct, specifically reactivated the UBE3A expression in hippocampian cerebellum, and this was accompanied also by a mild behavioral improvement. The main concern with this strategy is that repeated injections of a foreign large protein could cause allergic reaction, and we need to think about that problem. So, the last couple of slides relate to the question that actually surfaced due to the prospect of upcoming genetic therapies for AS, and then Yip Elgersma raised the question of whether or not there is a specific developmental window during which the therapeutic strategies will be effective in. And he did a really nice thing. He developed an AS Moran model that allows for temporarily controlled Cre-dependent induction of the maternal UBE3A, so he can actually switch on the UBE3A expression at whatever age of the mice that he would like to. He showed that these mice, when the Cre-activated activation took place in utero, they had a normal expression of the UBE3A and a normal behavioral functions. And then he performed the reactivation during three different developmental phases during childhood of the mice, adolescence, and adulthood. And he showed that the motor deficits were rescued when the reactivation were performed from adolescence and earlier, and the anxiety, repetitive behavior, and epilepsy were only rescued during the early development. So this would have a thing that all these genetic therapies should be introduced as early as possible. However, there is some good news also that hippocampal synaptic plasticity could be restored at any age. So this gives us some hope that with intensive work with the patient, even introducing genetic therapies at older ages could be beneficial for some learning and other cognitive skills. And actually, in the next international AS conference, which will be held this Friday, and I will be attending, we expect to hear from three pharmaceutical companies who will tell us how they plan to take the research, which was theoretical until now, regarding these different genetic strategies, and to take it to the next level of clinical therapies. So I guess, as I said, keep the hope. And this is a very exciting era, and we can expect to hear some great breakthroughs in the terms of genetic therapies for AS in the near future. Thank you very much. Any questions? Ditsa? Well, the global community is voting for the ASOS because it has shown already success. The recombinant proteins is very problematic because of the possible allergic reactions, and the topoisomerase inhibitors are currently have quite a toxicity profile. So I would vote for this, but you know, they're working constantly and improving their techniques. But I think it's very exciting for us physicians, researchers, and the patients also. Okay. Thank you very much.